On June 10th, 1991, Twin Peaks ended its original series run on ABC, airing the final two episodes back-to-back as a TV movie presentation. Many efforts by fans and the creators were made to try to save the series, and those efforts ultimately failed, and Twin Peaks was canceled.
Those popularity polls, we've been decreasing in them steadily. Mm-hmm. And there may be lots of reasons, but it doesn't make any difference. Now we're sort of in trouble, and we think that we have a good show and right. We can do well on a weeknight because we feel very strongly that the people who like Twin Peaks are party people. They
now,
enjoy.
What does that mean exactly?
They are not home on Saturday night.
Oh, I see. They're out.
They don't want to be home on Saturday night, and so to have the show on that would be wrong.
Right. The truth of it is, if you stop and think about it, it seems like it might be the kind of show that would be, you know, kind of have a limited run. And then would become a classic forever.
That's okay too.
Yeah.
If it has to end, you know, that's all right. But if it doesn't have to end, that's even better. Mm-hmm. And I'm asking people to write to Bob Iger, the president of ABC. Uh-huh. And if I could, I could give the address.
Oh yes, please do. Thanks. I love annoying these network weasels. Even if it's not this network, let's just annoy some network weasel here tonight.
The two episodes, Miss Twin Peaks and Beyond Life and Death, strung together that class tonally and artistically, ride out what was presumed to be the last of Twin Peaks, or Twin Peaks as we know it. Miss Twin Peaks was directed by Tim Hunter, while Beyond Life and Death was superbly directed by Lynch. One gives us the setup and structure while the other gets to deliver the payoff. Unfortunately, the audience has to endure moments of the last gasp of cringe that the majority of Season 2 delivered to the audience in the Miss Twin Peaks segments, which really drags the episode back from being great. Though it does aspire to moments of greatness, it is another example of these two completely different styles and tone that cause a rift in identity that becomes insufferable to the point of agony for the audience. But as Miss Twin Peaks comes to a close, it clears the road for David Lynch to return to the director's chair in one final moment of grace and triumph for Twin Peaks. Taking over the script and tone of the series, David Lynch gives his everything to Beyond Life and Death. It is an extraordinary cinematic feat, a masterpiece of art beyond film or television, returning the series to its former surreal glory right in time for its abrupt conclusion. By the time these episodes aired back-to-back, the series was already canceled. There was no hope for a revival in ABC's decision. It was even a miracle that we got a lot of the back half of Season 2, as painful as it is. Beyond Life and Death is my favorite episode of Twin Peaks, as far as the original series goes. It is a tragic, bittersweet, funny, and haunting 50 minutes that precedes television before the golden age of television. Once again, Lynch delivers the tone and atmosphere of cinematography and performances that complement that tone. It somewhat plays out at first in the usual crazy Twin Peaks fashion, but as the runtime counts down, things become stranger and weirder, as if you were spiked by some magnificent hallucinogen where your mind becomes a part of the episode, where you too become trapped inside the Black Lodge. As much as I've thrown shade on Season 2, we all owe the not-so-great episodes a debt of gratitude for doing a fantastic job at setting up the mythology of Twin Peaks and the Black Lodge. Most notably in Season 2, Episode 11, Dweller of the Threshold, and Hawk's speech about the lodges.
There is also a legend of a place called the Black Lodge, the shadow self of the White Lodge. The legend says that every spirit must pass through there on the way to perfection. There you will meet your own shadow self. My people call it the Dweller on the Threshold. But it is said, if you confront the Black Lodge with imperfect courage, it will utterly annihilate your soul.
Everything has been building up for Cooper's character in this moment of the majority of the episode, where he will be tested by strength and courage, and how ultimately this would-be hero of Twin Peaks would fail. But let's break it down. This episode, although mesmerizing, has a lot of wrap-up to do for a finale, and does so in chaotic Lynchian fashion, filled with cliffhangers and unknown ends for a lot of our beloved characters. Twin Peaks is unraveling upon itself. Secrets are revealed, and it is challenging for our characters, in spite of those characters trying to do the right thing, and for some causing their ultimate demise. Lynch wastes no time going through these wrap-up character scenes. Although some are paced slower than others, they have that Lynchian charm of tone and atmosphere before going into the main event. That main event, and the cherry on top, is the Black Lodge sequence. but we cannot keep our eyes off of it as Cooper goes to the spot in Glastonbury Grove, encircled by sycamore trees, as the practical dissolves reveals a red curtain that Cooper walks through to a destination we've seen but never experienced beyond a dream. Cooper enters the Red Room to the sounds of Jimmy Scott performing Sycamore Trees. The man from another place enters and dances slow. The mood, tension, and atmosphere, everything the series was building up to was this moment and this mesmerizing sequence. We enter and become possessed in Lynch's surreal dream place, one that we never want to wake up from. Callbacks to the foggy mountains and the bridge where Renette Pulaski walked that haunting stroll from the pilot as Sheriff Truman and Andy sit and wait, not knowing if they'll ever see Cooper again. In a scene not in the original script, added by Lynch, takes place in the Double R Diner, another callback to the pilot, showing that things have gone full circle. But the importance of adding this scene in my mind is planting a new seed, with the reemergence of Sarah Palmer delivering a message as a conduit for the Black Lodge, signifying that Sarah Palmer's importance beyond the mother of Laura Palmer is something more mystifying, but that will have to be a topic for another video. For the next 15 minutes, we as the audience belong to the Black Lodge. The tone is cold and the music is low, with a throbbing slow upright bass and simple guitar strokes and vague words said and phrases in the dialogue that give out such an importance of what Twin Peaks is evolving into. Doppelgangers, familiar faces, and absurd weirdness in the editing and the practical effects as Cooper slowly journeys through his search for Annie and Wyndham Earle, with some distractions on the way. Statements spoken by characters long gone that have now returned, planting even more seeds by Lynch for the future incarnations of Twin Peaks, including the infamous line from Laura Palmer.
Hello, Ashton Spoofer. I'll see you again in 25 years. Meanwhile.
That their business in his investigation of her is far from over, as we'll see. But again, that's another topic for another time. This was an all late night shoot, mostly improvised by Lynch to his ensemble, using practical effects and camera tricks to show that the Black Lodge is in some heightened reality. Time has no meaning. It slows down and speeds up in time, yet we are unaware of its effects, at least on first viewing. One example of this is when Cooper picks up his coffee. One moment it is frozen, the next it is normal, showing that time has many effects, yet it does not truly exist in this dreamscape dimension. As if the man from another place is controlling the flow of time in the Black Lodge by rubbing his palms together. Cooper walks through the lodge hallway, entering from left to right as if he were in a vortex, and each time he enters is a different setting, a different parallel dimension in a maze like a puzzle of confusion. With Laura's screams as a sort of forewarning, Cooper comes across himself and Annie as she switches back and forth with an image of Caroline, implicating what could happen to Annie if Cooper does the wrong thing or is defeated by his imperfect courage, as if the warning from the giant in episodes prior meant that Cooper can only doom Annie's fate. But all this confusion with Annie and Caroline is to ultimately trick Cooper into surrendering his soul to the Black Lodge.
If you give me your soul, I let Annie live.
I will.
Above Cooper and Earl's fatal mistake was in trusting that Earl could have his soul, and that Bob would just let him leave without consequence. Earl is annihilated and Cooper is trapped, giving birth to Cooper's worst nightmare, himself. The darker side corrupted as a being to cause chaos and sadness, pain and suffering. Cooper runs in fear as his doppelganger chases him and traps his existence inside the Black Lodge. Bob comes in front of the camera sinuously, knowing that something is not right and that the town of Twin Peaks will suffer because of Cooper's imperfect courage. We get a Cooper and Annie unconscious in Glastonbury Grove. Cooper wakes up in his hotel room, and we know by this first line of dialogue that this is not the Cooper we have grown to love, but something else entirely.
I need to brush my teeth.
The episode ends with the doppelganger bashing his head against the mirror, repeating the line, "How's Annie?" in a psychotic fashion.
How's Annie?
The audience is speechless as the end credits begin to roll of everyone's favorite special agent laughing maniacally. Although not intended as the end of the series, I have a feeling deep down Lynch and Frost knew that this would be the end. It is a reunion with different recurring cast members returning for one final bow out. Characters' journeys end abruptly with no reason or satisfying conclusion. In a way, this is a great ending for Twin Peaks, or at least the Twin Peaks that we knew prior to the return and even Fire Walk With Me. To me, Twin Peaks is about the balance of good and evil, and you cannot completely remove evil. You can only try to manage to balance the effects, whether in a physical or metaphorical way. Bob needed to find a new host, someone who he could again coexist with. What better match than the good-hearted FBI agent Dale Cooper, a manifestation of him of complete darkness and apathy. The darkness has returned to Twin Peaks, and as we see in the future incarnations, it is a reckoning of evil and the town returns to what it once was before the arrival of Special Agent Dale Cooper. This has been George Ray of All Things Lynchian, and I appreciate you checking out the video. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to like and share it so that it can reach more people, so we can get the word on the channel out there, and please subscribe for more Lynchian content. Thank you.